Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
Happy continuation of the feast of the Mother of God. The Lord has given many things to preach about in the Orthodox Church, but the difficulty is only deciding what to preach about. We had a plethora of possibilities today between the image of God not made with hands, the Holy Gospel, the Feast of the Dormition. And I selected the Gospel because it's one we always need to hear. Right previous to this passage, St. Peter asked the Lord how many times he should forgive someone who has transgressed against him. 7 times? Well, he thought he was doing something really great there, because most people do not forgive 7 times. That was not the typical Jewish standard. But the Lord tells him, I say not 7 times, but up to 70 times 7, which in the speak of that time meant every single time, forever, always. Always to forgive, never an option. And it's one commandment in the scriptures that is reiterated and passed over and over and over and over again. And we are not given an option for. Of course, there are no optional commandments. But this commandment in particular is one that we need to take very seriously. St. John Chrysostom tells us that it is the one thing we should struggle against, to bear with our enemies' difficulties, that they cause us, to be gentle with them. He says, I know that it is hard, but the Lord will make it easy if we just try. He says, when we fail in our own attempts to overcome our own sins, we can accomplish by being gentle with those who are our enemies. It's a good thing to hear. But how quick we are to judge, how quick we are to be angry with other people and fester, let it fester in our hearts without dealing with it. We justify ourselves, but as I've told many of you that I read recently, St. Theophan the Recluse says that he who has a dead body in his house does not worry about other people's funerals. When we have a corpse in our own soul, we should be taking care of the stinking corpse, not what's going on out around us, and worrying about what they're doing. They'll take care of that. We know that the entire chapter of Dorotheus of Gaza on the refusal to judge one's neighbor, which everyone in the church should read at least yearly, if not more often. We do not know the circumstances of other people's lives. We do not know why they do the things we do. And for the most part, they're not out to get us. And even if they are, why would we let someone control our own souls? Why do we want to enslave our souls to someone else's actions when we have a choice? The Lord gives us a very stark warning today in this parable. This man who has a servant who comes to him and owes him a significant amount of money, really tens of millions of dollars in the way we would describe it now, amount that he can never possibly pay back. But because of his fervent pleas that he will be forgiven this debt and to give him time, his master shows mercy upon him, where in truth, nothing was deserved, but the master was merciful. The Jewish law allowed for him to be cast into prison over such a thing. But the Lord, the master that he had, representing the Lord, of course, showed him mercy. So what does he go out and do? Because he wants to pay this money off so desperately, he finds a servant of his who owes a very, very insignificant amount of money. Not even a few months' wages, even if that. Maybe a few days' wages. And he begins to choke him because the pagan law allowed to torture someone who was not paying back their debt. And he begins to do so. But the servants of the master, seeing what had already happened, of course are mortified by what they are witnessing, and go and tell the master what they have seen. The master, of course, is furious because he showed so much mercy upon this man. And because of his actions, he is cast into prison until he can pay off the very last debt, which he will never be able to do. And we need to take that sternly, because the Lord is telling us something there. If we do not forgive our brethren, we too shall be cast into eternal prison, which there is no getting out. Is it horrifying? Yes. But if it's horrifying, take it seriously. Today, not tomorrow, anybody that you have something against, forgive them.
Don't wait till you feel like it. Make the decision to do it. Because if you wait till you feel like it, you might not ever do it. Most likely, you never will. Remember Metropolitan Jonah's homily about do not resent, do not react, keep inner stillness. But oh, do we resent, and do we react, which we have no inner stillness because of. We hold these things, and we find ourselves, as I've said many times in prayer, at night, and we cannot pray because somebody keeps coming back to mind, what that person did to me. Why did we let that happen? It's not worth the time. Let it go and pray. I was recently listening to some homilies I told you about from Father Maximus from Simonopetra, who said that he was teaching a class at Holy Cross Seminary, and he was walking across campus one day. I've told some of you the story. And a man, one of the professors, said something extremely rude to him. But he said he didn't have time to deal with it right then because he had to go teach his class. He says to himself, what is that about? And he goes and teaches the class, and he remains busy. And he gets home to his apartment that night. As he takes off his hat, sits down for a minute just to be silent. He's a man very well trained in the monastic life. And he said, what happens then? There's that thought. Waiting all day just for that moment. Are you going to let him do that to you? He's going to think you're weak. Don't let him do that to you. Say something. Be passive aggressive with him. Do something. Be angry. But he said he thought about it just for a second. And because this man had such training in being attentive to his own heart, he said, no, I don't have time for that. This is going to take me away from God. It's not going to make me get even with that person. It's going to take me away from God, which is a much bigger thing. Now, I could probably go around the room and talk to every individual in here, and certainly everyone I've heard their confessions for many years, and all the times I've heard anger, all the times I've confessed anger, not yet has it worked. In my experience, it has never worked. I remember a story Bishop Kalistos tells of the Russian confessor in England one time who the nun at the convent they had there made this priest hear confessions. He hated hearing confessions. And she said, you've got to because the people need it. So he never said anything to confess. He just read the prayer, typically. And one day, this woman was talking about incessantly, complaining about her husband and how she bickered with him and she bickered with him and she was angry. And at the end of it, he just looked at her and said, did it work? She stops. No, it never has. And she was changed from that moment. She stopped it. Because all of our bickering, all of our sitting behind the scenes complaining about others, what they said, what they might have said, what we perceive they said, is not going to fix anything. Remember the Lord, forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do. Remember St. Stephen, lay not this sin to their charge. Those were pretty bad things that were being done to them. Now, we must be wise as servants. We don't have to be stupid and let people continue to harm us all the time. But we still have to forgive and not let it weigh on our hearts constantly. Remind them when I was reading this week, and it's a story I know I told you years ago, but some of you may not remember it. It's one of my favorite patristic stories. There are many, but this one is up there. St. Titus of the Kiev Caves, who reposed in 1190, one of the many incorrupt saints that lie in the caves of Anthony and Theodosius. St. Titus was a priest, found worthy of the priesthood in Kiev, in the monastery, and he had a deacon that served with him who was very close with Evagrius. Well, as communal life tends to be, little things got in the way after a while, like living in a family. But they let this build up, and they let it build up, and they didn't go do something about it. They didn't have the humility to forgive one another and to bear insults. So they got to the point where these two men became so despicable with one another that when one would sense in the church, the other one would walk out. So they didn't want to be sensed by that person. Imagine such behavior. When we condemn this, and how often do we hold grudges against others and complain to others in the church about them and our family about them and talk and talk and talk and talk. It doesn't fix. It spreads poison. So after many years, St. Titus is on his deathbed. He's stricken suddenly with illness. And he begs that they bring Evagrius to his cell because he wants to forgive Evagrius. They drag Evagrius there physically. He does not want to come. Monks will do these things. And he bowed down before him in his great illness and said, "Forgive me for having offended and wounded you in my anger, and bless me." Evagrius says, "I will never forgive you in this world or in the world to come." At that moment, Titus gets up, healthy. Evagrius drops dead on the spot. Everybody, of course, is in horror. They ask Titus what he saw at that moment. Titus said, "The minute I made the decision to forgive my brother, I saw all the demons depart from me at once." That should be inspiration for us. "And I saw a spear as it come from heaven strike Evagrius. The same spear touched me and took my rage and anger and hatred away." Evagrius lived out his life in repentance and became a great saint. Judge not and you will not be judged. We all have our failings. We all fall short of the glory of God. We all fall short of the great saints of the church and their ascetic efforts. But if we refuse to judge others, that doesn't mean, once again, because I always know I have to clarify myself on these matters, that doesn't mean that we say sin is good. That doesn't mean we justify other people's sins and say that's okay for them to do that or my sins either. But it does mean we show mercy to them and try to bring them to repentance and forgiveness. Judge not and you will not be judged. Use it as inspiration. Remember the example of Titus. Remember the example of Evagrius. Should inspire us to stop bickering about one another, to stop holding grudges, to stop bearing resentments, and to try to exercise just a little bit of humility, because that is the way we will find the kingdom of God. Amen.